Good afternoon, everyone. This is Robert Jamieson. Welcome to our online chess lesson for Thursday the 24th of October. Today I've tried to give you some extra entertainment by putting a picture of a very famous old chess player on the screen. So I need someone to help me discuss all this because I don't have anyone in the office with us today. So let's start with Brijesh. There, Brijesh?
Yep.
How are you today?
I'm good.
Did you work out who the photo was?
No.
It's very difficult because he's really old and has a really big beard, but if you...
I tried looking it up on the internet, but I couldn't find it.
Couldn't find it. Okay. Well, to work out who it is, you have to be really clever, like Benji, who noticed that the person's name is at the top of the picture. So everyone have a look up there. It is in fact Wilhelm Steinitz, who was the first world chess champion in the late 19th century.
I thought that was like a trick. It looked too obvious.
Yes, well, it's like a chessboard. You've got to look around the whole board and see all the moves, not just in one area of it. So for those of you who knew it without looking at the name, well done. To obviously know your chess and have studied the history of chess and stuff. Now, there's a reason why I'm showing a picture of Wilhelm Steinitz up there today. And in those days, in the 19th century, they weren't sort of really polished chess players. They were just sort of working out what to do. They liked attacking, stuff like that. And Steinitz was a very strong player, but he had a slightly strange idea about how to play. And the king was an attacking piece. So often in his games, he wouldn't castle. He'd leave his king in the middle, and sometimes he'd go thundering around the board with his king when most other players would be trying to hide it in the corner. So that's going to fit in with the game I'm going to show you today, and also our puzzle. I'll get rid of Mr. Steinitz. Right, so let's have a look at the puzzle. Brijesh, would you have any thoughts?
Rook takes F7.
Rook is probably okay. You can take the G pawn check, but I'm not sure you can do much after that.
Or maybe King H2.
Yeah, what does that do? You're just waiting and hoping he self-destructs or something?
No, I'm just trying to I thought of like putting the knight into g5, but it's checkmate on g2.
Yeah, we'd love to play knight g5, but then the queen will rip into g2. So that would be terrible. So it's a bit of a struggle. We'd love to play g4 to try and open up the king, but then the knight can be taken. So that's a bit of a problem too. So poor old white sitting there, thinking, what can I do? But then have a look at Black's position. So his rooks can't really do much. His king's in the pickle. It can't move anywhere because then f7 would be on 3. His bishop could maybe go to c8, but his queen can't really do much. So poor old Black hasn't got much to do either.
Can't we do something like rook f7?
F4. Well, rook f4, but then you're losing the other rook on d7.
But then can we bring the knight to g5?
We could, but the only trouble is black would then say, I want to change off the queen, and he'd go queen e7. So once we lose the queen, we're not going to get a checkmate.
Oh, okay.
All right. So let's just go back. So one of the things I've told you guys that the main thing about chess is your pieces. You want to get active pieces, put your pieces on good squares. And if you don't know what to do, Brijesh, you got any idea about your pieces? What could we do if we can't think of a good plan?
Yeah.
Any idea what we could do with our, find our worst place piece and what would we do with it?
Improve its position.
Yeah, so I say if you're stuck, just have a look around, say what's my worst piece, and try and find a better spot for it. So no, this is a very famous... Yep.
What about knight e1?
Well, but is e1 a better spot than f3?
No.
He's sort of going backwards. So Short, this is Nigel Short, the very famous British grandmaster. he said, all right, he'll do British's move, we'll just do King H2. Maybe the other guy will self-destruct or something. So the other guy said, all right, that's no big deal. I'll just move my rook backwards and forth. Maybe we're both stuck and we'll have a draw.
Is it dry? Is that corrupt?
So, Bridges, what would be your follow-up to King H2? You got any idea?
King G3.
Yeah, let's go King G3. Let's, hang on, here we go. King G3. Maybe black will self-destruct. The black says, all right, well, I'll just go back again. If you want to repeat moves or something, we'll have a draw. What do you think, Bridges? Would you have a draw or you got an idea?
I probably want to do knight g5 or king f4, but I think king f4 is better so you won't get chipped.
All right, let's do king f4, and he just puts the bishop back. Now he's attacking your rook.
Yeah.
So what are you going to do about that?
I'm not really sure. Maybe we can bring the knight in or something. I'm not sure.
Okay. So what's the king doing out of that f4? Do you think you're Steinitz and you want to attack with your king or something, or are you just...
Oh, yeah, king g5.
Yes. What a brilliant move. King g5. The king is an attacking piece, and in fact, poor old black had to resign here because he can't really do anything to stop king h6. So, for instance, if he played king h7, we can just play queen takes... check. And if he just takes the rook, we finish our king march, king h6, and the next move, it's the checkmate on g7. So what a wonderful move.
Yeah, I kind of only chose that move because you talked about that guy, the grandmaster, yeah, who thinks the king's an attacking, yeah, piece.
Well, this is one of the few examples in grandmaster chess where the king really is an attacking piece, and Short came up with this brilliant idea. All his other pieces were on good spots, but his king wasn't helping, so he thought, why don't I hoon in with my king? And he got that wonderful checkmate. Okay, so so maybe Steinitz was right. Let's have a look and see what we can do today. Okay, we'll write up the moves. All right, now what I want to talk about today. Let's talk about the king still being an attacking piece. I have a question for everyone. Let's say we're in an endgame. So in the endgame, the king isn't worried about being checkmated anymore, and it can sort of help out doing things like promoting pawns or attacking stuff or whatever. What do you reckon the king is worth? Do you reckon it's worth 2 pawns, 3 pawns, 4 pawns, or 5 pawns? On the question box, type in what you reckon the king is worth in the end game. 2, 3, 4, or 5 pawns. Nathaniel likes 4, Gil likes 3, Joey 4, Bridges 5, Josh 5, Derek 4, Maha 5. So Bridges, you chose 4, why did you choose 4?
I was really thinking about how many squares the king can protect at once. Yeah, but 5 was the most, so I
went
with that.
All right, well, I think you're right. The general consensus is a king is worth 4 pawns, so it's better than a bishop or a knight, but not quite as good as a rook. So in the end game, when you're not in danger of being checkmated, the king is a powerful piece, and you probably need to use it to help out your other pieces to achieve what you're trying to do in the ending. All right, now let's move on to today's game. Now, one of the things I'm finding in coaching juniors is that they have funny ideas sometimes. So, for instance, some juniors might think, oh, double pawns are really, really terrible. I couldn't possibly have a double pawn. And they might end up losing a piece rather than get their pawns doubled, which is just silly. So sometimes they get their ideas a little bit out of kilter. And today's game is between 2 young players. I think it was the playoff for the under 11 or something like that at the Vic Youth the other day. Sean Zillman, he's only 7. I coach him. He's not a bad player. And I don't know Tian Ming Hua or whatever his name is, but he was white and this was the playoff game. Now, both these players have funny ideas. Both of them, they like swapping. I think a lot of juniors like swapping, just piece for piece, which is really only a good idea if you get some sort of advantage out of it. If you get a disadvantage from a swap, generally you wouldn't do it. But I know I've watched little Oliver Cordova play, and as soon as he can take something, his hand rushes out and he goes, bishop takes knight, and he's got another one of his opponent's pieces. You like swapping, Brijesh, or you're over that? You've moved on to the next level.
I'm moved on.
Good, good, okay. The other two things these guys like, white is a funny player because he's like Steinitz. He reckons the king is an attacking piece. And we're going to have a look at the game, and I'll show you what sort of trouble he gets into with his king being an attacking piece. And his opponent, Sean, his problem is he likes checking. Every opportunity he'll get, he'll give you a check. Maybe he's hoping that one of them will be a checkmate or something like that. I don't know. But just checking for the sake of checking is not really a good plan. So we'll see how that works in today's game. All right. I'll move on, Brijesh, and give someone else a go. So thanks for your help with that.
Thank you.
All right. Let's try Derek. You there, Derek? Hello, Derek. Say something. Are you going to talk to me? Nope. All right. Like Derek. We'll try Joey. You there, Joey?
Yeah, hello.
Hello? You didn't get that puzzle, King H2? Have you seen that before?
No.
No, it's pretty hard. You've got to be a really good player to see that. Anyway, hopefully you can help me start off today's game and I'll get your thoughts. All right, here we go. So it goes E4, C6. So it's a Caro Kann opening. White plays D4 to get his two pawns side by side. Black plays D5. All right, what do you normally do here, Joey, if you play against the Caro Kann?
Knight C3.
Yeah, Knight C3 is sort of the main line. And black takes the pawn and white takes back. Now, all this is pretty normal. What do you think black should do here?
Bishop F5.
Yeah, the normal move is Bishop F5 and then the knight goes back, attacking the bishop goes back. Sometimes white throws the h-pawn up to try and trap the bishop and black makes a hidey hole and off we go like that. Bishop f5 is a normal move. You could do knight d7 or knight f6. They're both okay. But Sean comes up with a funny move. He plays queen d5, attacking the knight. All right, what do you want to do about that, Joey? What would you think would be good? Knight's attack, so you're going to have to move it or defend it.
Knight to c5 or queen to f3 both look okay to me.
Okay. Is c5 a good square for the knight? Where's it going? Like no. Next move, maybe I play e5 on you.
Yep.
Will that worry you?
Yep.
Yeah, the pickle. All right, so maybe not knight c5. Queen f3. Is that a good spot for the queen? We're happy to get our queen out like that?
Okay.
Probably white could just go back, play knight c3, chase the queen away. That'd be okay. But in the game, he does a different move. He does bishop d3. Yeah, what's the problem with that, do you think?
The queen's no longer defending the pawn on d4.
Yeah, he's sort of sacrificing a pawn. If you were black, would you take it, or is it too dangerous?
I think I'd take it.
Yeah, I think I'd take it. One, three pawn, let's take it. All right. White's next move, pretty obvious.
Knight to f3.
Yep, so we hit the queen with developing move. All right, now question for everyone. Our queen's attacked, where should we retreat it to? So in the question box, type in where you reckon that queen should go. So Bridget wants c6, Jim wants c6, Maha wants c8. Harry loves c6. Daniel wants to go d8. Well, what do you reckon, Joey? What's the best one?
Probably b6.
All right. Why did you choose b6?
The queen's still a bit active, but then it could... Oh, no. Actually, I'm not sure.
Okay. All right. Well, the rule is when we have to move one of our pieces, we ask ourselves, what is the best spot for it? So I would, were it me, I think I would go to b6. We're putting a bit of pressure on the b2 pawn. So for instance, white can't play bishop e3 because it's b2 pawn will be on. And our queen's sort of a little bit developed, so that's not too bad. In the game, black went all the way back to the start, the d8. So he's like lost a couple of moves with his queen now. All right. Black's a pawn ahead, but white has got in three developing moves. He's got the bishop and two knights developed. So would you rather be black with a pawn or white with a development, you think, Joey? What do you reckon?
Probably white.
Okay, well, why do you say that?
With that many pieces out, it shouldn't be too difficult to get a pawn back. And
yes, okay. In fact, it's white's move, so if he wanted, he could develop another piece and have four to none. Right, the general rule of thumb is a pawn is worth three developing moves. So if you've only got two moves for it, I'd probably rather have the pawn. If you've got three, it's probably pretty even. If you've got four, it's probably good for white. All right, so, but white's got to do something fairly quickly, because if he just fiddles around, black will get his pieces out, and white won't be ahead in development, and white will just be a pawn down. So the next move might be an important move for white to decide what he wants to do. So I'll give you guys a choice of three moves. Now, what do we say? Right, let's say first move, you could castle kingside. All right, second choice, maybe we'll move the bishop somewhere. Let's say it's bishop f4. Or third choice, maybe we start attacking straight away. We'll play knight e5. So you guys find which one of those you prefer. Castle, bishop f4. Or knight e5. So Bridges is liking castles, Daniel and Derek like bishop f4, Maha wants the castle as well, Joshua likes bishop f4, Gil and Noam likes bishop f4, Nathaniel wants the castle. What do you reckon, Joey? What should we do?
Knight e5 could be okay.
So your preference would be knight e5. Most of the others are going for bishop f4 or castles. You want to attack straight away, do you?
Possibly, yeah.
Okay. All right. Well, the white player agrees with you. He played knight e5. All right. Now, my next question. So it's black's go now. White's got three attacking pieces in the center of the board. What do you reckon black should play here? So type in what move you would play for black. Rajesh is going knight d7, Gil's going f6, Joey's going knight d7, Joshua's going bishop f5, Daniel's going knight d7. So we've got three different moves. Maha likes bishop f5. Nathaniel likes knight d7. So, Joey, you like knight d7. Is that your choice?
Yeah.
All right. Why did you choose that one?
Well, first of all, it would be trying to get rid of the attacker. Yep. And if you choose to move your knight from g8 to f6 and they capture, you don't have to recapture.
Yep. Okay. All right. I have a really silly question for everyone. Have you looked at all checks and captures? Joey, have you looked at all checks and captures? Black to play. No. Oh, we'll give it a quick go. Just humour me.
Queen takes d3.
Is that a good move?
No.
No, lose a queen. Any other checks or captures to look at? Three people have seen it, four people, five people. Come on, Joey. Checks or captures?
Check.
There aren't too many.
Oh, Queen A5.
Yeah, Queen A5 wins the knight, wins a free piece. End of game. You've won. But no one here saw it. What do you reckon?
I guess white's lost now.
I guess white's lost. But in the game, white didn't see it, and in the game, black didn't see it, just like us. We weren't looking for it. So that's one of the reasons perhaps you guys should focus on checks and captures occasionally. You might pick up a spare knight. So Lucky let off. He played knight f6. All right, should we take that? I think we'll take that and double his pawns. All right. Question for everyone now. Where should white put his knight? Because his knight's attacked. Where should the knight go? So we can go to g4, f3, c4. It's got three choices. Who likes g4? Bridget likes g4. Maha likes f3. Derek's f3. Daniel's c4. Thomas wants queen e2 because he wants to lose a knight. What do you reckon, Joey? Where would you put it?
Probably c4.
Right. Why do you choose c4?
Because it's still kind of aggressive.
Yeah, again, we've got to say what is the best square. So if we put it back to f3, maybe the bishop can come and pin it or something. C4 looks like a good square. It's sort of controlling d6. If he puts the bishop there, we could take him. Or it could go back to e3 if necessary. Not too bad. In the game, white put it on g4. Which looks a bit funny to me, because he's not sort of going forwards anywhere. All right, so white's put his knight on a slightly funny square. Black to play. What do you reckon we should do?
Capture.
Type in, you guys. We could capture it. All right, so one option is to take, as Joey's suggesting. Anyone else have any other ideas? Bridges wants to take it. Derek wants to play g6. Daniel wants to play bishop c5. Josh wants bishop e6. Well, we've got a few moves there. So, Joey, you want to take it. Tell me about that. Why do you want to take it?
Bucks a pawn up, and by taking it, their attack's almost over.
So are you worried about that knight attacking you?
Not really.
Is white recapturing with a developing move?
Yes.
Which is the better piece, the bishop or the knight, or is much of a much worse?
Bishop?
The bishop. Knight. The knight. Bishop. Which one? You can't have both.
Equal.
Pretty equal. All right, but as I said at the start, the players like swapping. So black should probably, well, if we take with an bishop takes knight, which is what happened, white recaptures with developing move, and we've lost what's going to be a reasonably good bishop. So I think that's a boo-boo. We don't just take because we feel like it. Black has, in fact, has a tricky move. Oh, Nathaniel got it. What about Nathaniel? He could try bishop b4 check. Now, Joey, so white would obviously play c3. What could black do then?
Bishop takes g4.
Yeah, so now he could have a look at bishop takes g4. queen takes, then these three bishops on three. It gets a bit messy because he's got to look about queen c8 check or queen g7. So I'm not totally sure it's good, but certainly it's worth a look and probably better than bishop takes knight. All right, so again I say don't just take pieces because we can, particularly when he recaptures the developing move. All right, I might move on and give someone else a go. So thanks for help, Joey. Let's try Joshua, see if Joshua's there. Joshua, do you have your microphone working tonight? Earth to Joshua. Nope, I don't think Joshua has a microphone. All right, we'll try Nathaniel. You there, Nathaniel?
Yes.
How are you?
Good, thanks.
That's good. So you can help me with the next bit of the game, I'm hoping?
Yeah, I can.
All right. So it's Black's go. I'll give you guys a choice of two moves. So Black can either play Queen d7 or Knight d7. So type in what you reckon is the better move. Queen d7 or Knight d7. So let's see. Gil likes Knight. Daniel likes Knight. Nathaniel likes Queen. Bridges likes Queen. Arthur likes Knight. It's pretty even. Thomas likes Queen. Maha Queen. What do you reckon, Nathaniel? Do you prefer the Queen or the Knight?
I prefer the Queen, so you can drive that active Queen away, because your King's quite open and you don't want that Queen around. And also, if he trades, you can get your Knight active.
Yeah, all right. So Queen d7, that was the move he played. So now if White takes, you recapture with developing moves, so that's good. But what if White just goes back, maybe say f3? So the question then is, what are you doing with your knight? Where is your black knight going?
I was thinking of going something like you would attack with your queen to the king, and then your knight could kind of come out then.
Maybe. I'm inclined to think perhaps not queen d7. You can see Black's idea, he's trying to swap queens because he loves swapping pieces and stuff. But probably just knight d7. Let me get rid of the arrow and try and make it normal. So knight d7, so that's a better square for the knight. And we're threatening to come out knight e5 probably with the double attack on the queen and the bishop.
Yeah.
So it's not too bad. All right, but so if I were Black, I would be more thinking about, can I put my pieces on good squares, as opposed to thinking, can I try and swap some pieces? Just swapping pieces is a real good plan. Because we're only one double pawn up. It's not the end of the world sort of thing. But silly old White, instead of retreating the queen, of course, he loves taking, so he swaps, and now Black recaptures the developing move. So we've returned the favour. What do you reckon White should do now?
I think maybe White should try castle so he could get his king safe and maybe a rook to attack that king.
Mm-hmm. All right, castles are probably pretty good, or we could move our bishop somewhere, maybe bishop f4, something like that. But in fact, he does a really funny move. He does king e2. So what do you think he's up to?
I think he's trying to get his king active.
Yes, he's attacking with his king. Now, admittedly, we're in endgame, but the other guy's still got two rooks, a bishop and a knight, and our king's really open, and there's not much to attack. I think our king's going to get in the way more than anything. So White's got this sort of idea in his head that the king is an attacking piece, and it's not going to work for him. All right. Black's go, so Black should probably move his bishop somewhere, I'm thinking. Let's have a look, see what he does. Bishop c5, all right, that looks like a pretty good square. White goes bishop e3. All right, so again, he's trying to swap pieces. All right, let's give you guys three choices here. So first choice, maybe black should swap pieces because he's after all a pawn ahead. So bishop takes bishop, option one. Option two, maybe he should castle kingside. Or option three, maybe he should castle queenside. All right, so type in what you reckon. Derek wants to take. Neil wants to castle kingside. Thomas wants to castle kingside. Daniel's a kingside. Nathaniel's a queenside. Bridges kingside. Arthur's a queenside. Maha's a queenside. So we've got a lot of different choices. Joshua wants to play kingside. Bridges wants to take the bishop. What do you reckon, Nathaniel?
I've done the queen side just so the king always has like a quick way to get out, and also the two rooks are both kind of quite can get onto the e-file to put pressure on the bishop. And
I agree. I think the best move is castle's queen side. Now let's just have a quick look. Let's say black castled kingside. Now, white is a pawn down, but he has one really good chance of getting a draw if he can set something up. And he can set it up in this position. So if black were to castle kingside, like a lot of you guys wanted, what would be white's next move that would give him a good chance for a draw? So type in, what are you thinking, caps on? Because white's losing, he's got to think of a way how he can get a draw. So what would be the move? Bridges wants to give up his bishop by bishop takes h7. Don't think that's too hot. Derek wants to take on c5. No, he's changed his mind and found a better move. Arthur wants bishop h6, which seems to just lose a bishop. Gil wants king f3, which would fit in with the attacking plan, but not real good. Okay, now Nathaniel, what was your idea?
I wanted to do bishop f5 just to kind of try like attack the knight. But
so, how does that help? Why do you want to attack the knight?
Because it's protecting the bishop, but he'd probably just take my bishop first.
He'd take your bishop, so what would you do then?
I would take it with my king and start trying to get my king active.
Are you sure that's the best move here? Are there other moves to look at? He's just taken your bishop on e3.
Oh, maybe you take the knight.
Let's try taking the knight. Now, why would this give you good drawing chances?
Because you have a... because you have control of the e-file?
Nope. Come on, we need someone to help us. Type in the question if you know. Why would white have good drawing chances after this exchange? Bridgesh has got it. Gil's got it. Arthur's got it. You want another go, Nathaniel? Because of, look at the bishops. What's different about the bishops?
Oh, black squared, white squared.
Yeah, bishops of opposite colour. So black's ones on black squares, white ones on white squares. So it's notoriously hard to get a win if the bishops are on opposite colours. Because they can sort of never contest with each other. One controls half the board, the other controls the other half of the board. So, in fact, black, white would have had a good chance in this position if black castled, bishop f5 gets the bishops of opposite colour. If instead we do your idea, which was castle's queenside, it's not a problem now because the knight's not undefended. So if he takes our knight, we just take him back. All right. But that's not what happened in the game, I think. What did he do? He did do castle, sorry. And then, of course, white. He saw an exchange, bishop for bishop, fantastic. Of course, black recaptures with the knight moving forwards onto a good square and attacking the bishop. So again, white's done a trade just for the sake of it. And it's not a good trade. All right, black's go. What would you do, Nathaniel?
Free
move. You want a free move?
Yeah.
So, what is your free move? How can you get a free move? Free developing move.
Maybe rook d1. Rook A.
No, rook. Oh, hang on, what's happened here? Oh, sorry, I was thinking it was black's move. Yeah, black's going to get a free move with rook E8 check, because white's got his silly king in the middle. But white now does B4. What do you think of that? Good move, bad move?
I think he's kind of like basically setting up for a trade. I think it's probably is maybe a good move because he can kind of like later get his king over there to support his pawns.
All right. I'm inclined to think it's a bad move because I think this B4 pawn might be a bit of weakness.
Yeah.
And poor old white, I mean, it's not a developing move. Let's go back to where, here we are. See, white's got his two rooks just sitting there, not helping him at all. He's got nice pawn structure. His pawns are all sitting there in a row, so the pawns are nice and solid. But the rooks aren't helping him. B4 is just sort of creating a weak pawn and weak square on C3 and stuff like that. Mm. So
he should probably be doing that. Maybe getting rook one of his rooks.
Rook D1 or something to protect the bishop, so if knight takes, we can take with the rook. Something like that would probably be good. Anyway, he goes B4. All right, I'll give someone else a go. So thanks for your help, Nathaniel. Let's try Oscar. You there, Oscar? Can you talk to me, Oscar? No, he's not coming up. What about Thomas? You there, Thomas?
Yeah.
Hello, Thomas. How are you tonight?
Good.
Okay, so what do you think about the attacking king so far? Is it going all right?
No. I would have preferred the castle.
Yeah, it gets a lot worse. I'll show you in a minute. All right, so you're black, your knight's attacked. What should you do for black?
Wait. Ash, can you please be quiet?
You want that free move I talked about?
Rook E8.
Yeah, let's go Rook E8. So we put our rook on open file, force his king to move again. So his king goes to D2. All right, what do you want to do now? Your knight's still attacked. You could take the bishop, or you could retreat for the knight, or go somewhere else, or what do you want to do?
Take the bishop.
Okay. I think that's what he did. Probably the best move. Let's just have a little look. Oh, hang on. I've got to get rid of this red. Sorry. All right. I reckon the best move would be knight e4 check. So now, obviously, if the king moves to the e-file, we've got a discovered attack and we win the exchange. But if he plays bishop takes knight, we recapture, and now you'll notice that our rook is attacking this b-pawn.
Mm.
So white will probably have to defend that, and that'll give us time to get our other rook in. So we're like gaining a move with the attack on that b-pawn. But in the game, black didn't do that. He chopped the bishop, and white naturally took with his king, because the king is a fantastic attacking piece. So now, it's going to be the king versus the rooks. What would you do here?
A rook d8.
Yeah, let's put our other rook on the d-file. We're a pawn up. We've got both our rooks active. All right, where should white go? Should he go to c3 or c4?
C3.
Why did you say c3?
Because that keeps away from the pawns at the other end, so, and you can hide in.
Yeah, well, he should be thinking about hiding and making his king safe. So king to c3, but white's still thinking the king is an attacking piece. So he goes king c4. He's going to lunge up there and finish off those rooks and the pawns just with his king.
I don't think so.
No, I don't think so either, but we'll see. All right, black to play. What do you reckon?
B5.
B5? Why do you choose B5?
Because that then either forces the king to go back, or if he moves forward, you can move your rook to D5.
All right, well, let's see what other people think. So guys. Type in B5 if you agree with Thomas. If you've got a different move, type in what move you guys would play. So Derek's going Rook E5. Gil's going Rook E4 check. Josh is going B6. We're just trying Rook D2. Josh has now changed his mind, gone Rook E2. Daniel likes your B5. Oscar likes Rook E4. We're getting moves all over the shop. Okay. So, you like any of those, or you still reckon B5 check is the way to go, Thomas?
I still like B5.
All right, question for you. B5 check. Can you work out a way to checkmate his king, like if he goes forwards or something?
Or if he goes forwards...
He might go back, sure. Can you work out a checkmating sequence or something, or not?
If he goes forwards, I can.
Okay. What if he goes backwards?
Not so much, no.
Okay. So one of the ways to win the game is to checkmate the king, which eventually wins all the games. But you know, you can focus on trying to get a checkmate in this position, or you can do something different. What can you do if you're not focusing on a checkmate?
Defending.
But he's not attacking you. Why would you defend if he's not attacking?
Well, it's the attacking king.
Yeah, but he's not threatening anything with it. But in general, so in theory, if you're playing a game, you might think, all right, I'm playing to get a checkmate at the moment. So you bring all your pieces over, you sacrifice, you try and get a checkmate quickly. But maybe you don't have an attacking position like that. So what can you do instead to win the game?
Well, try and force him to make mistakes.
Even better, think of it like an army, you can take all his pieces. You can kill his men. You can take his pawns and his rooks and stuff. And when he's got no army left, then you checkmate him later at your leisure. So in this position, Black shouldn't be thinking about checkmate. He should be saying, hey, White's blundered. I'm just going to play, say, Rook D2. Now I've got a double attack on the C2 pawn. I've got a double attack on the F2 pawn. So I'm winning another pawn. I've got my rook in the ideal spot on the 7th. I'll just gobble all his bits and I'll beat him later. That'd be pretty simple, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
The only thing you have to worry about is you don't get a back rank checkmate. So maybe you sort of push a pawn up or something so your king's safe. But... All right, now as I said at the start, Black's problem, apart from wanting to swap, is he loves checking. And he loves pointless check. So in this position, he did your move. B5 check. Well, you might go yay, but it's not a good move. It's just forcing the king back to safety, so like, could go king C3, and then your rook can't go to D2 or E2 with a double attack, it'll just be a single attack. Or his king can come forward, and now you've got a weak c-pawn that the king's in fact attacking. So we shouldn't give checks just for the sake of checks. We should only give it if it's helping us. Maybe if it's leading to a checkmate, that's fine, but here I'm not sure. All right, Black's go. So his king's gone forward. He's being very brave. What do we want to do? What do you think?
Rook E5, check that, because that will, if he comes forward, then we can just use the two rooks and back rank him.
We could go Rook E5, check, and he'll probably take the pawn, and then he'll have an attacking king. Here, Black, I think, panicked a little bit, and he went Rook C8. He said, oh, that king's attacking my pawn. So now, in fact, whereas before he had a really aggressive rook on the D-file, now he's got a defensive rook, and White's got an attacking king. So White said, all right, I'm going to challenge rooks.
Okay, Black said, Rook
D8. You could go Rook D8. You'd be trying for the sneaky checkmate, but then he could challenge with the other rook, so it wouldn't quite work. All right, what Black said is, I don't want to swap rooks because you have the file. I'll play Rook D5 check. All right, what do you reckon White should do now?
take it.
So what would happen? That wouldn't that undouble his pawns? We've got a good follow up.
Otherwise, he's moving to more on to like more towards the rooks, where it'll be checkmated or into the open.
All right. So if you were white, what move would you play here?
Now, rook either d1 or e1.
Right. Which one? D1 or E1? Shall we say E1?
D1,
correct. Rooks belong on open files. So, in fact, in this position, white is winning because he has an active king and an active rook. So the next time the rook's going to go up to the 7th, and it doesn't matter if he's a pawn down, he has active pieces. He's actually winning the game. But, in fact, white didn't do that. Because he thought, geez, this is working out really well for me. My king can attack even more. So I'm playing king d6. Look at that. All right, so Thomas, what are we going to do? His king is really attacking us now. What? Can we checkmate him or finish him off? Or force him to sacrifice? What can we do?
Look, d8.
You guys can help. Type in the questions. All right, you're suggesting rook d8 check. Do you guys agree, or you want to do something different? Type in what you reckon. Gil wants to do rook d5. He's saying not rook d8.
Yeah, rook Derek, d5 looks good.
Derek says rook d5 mate, but it's not mate, Derek. We can go to e7. Arthur's looking at rook e6, but I could just take it. Joey says rook d5, but he's not sure. Nathaniel, rook d5. Oh, you changed your
rook
mind?
D5.
Yeah. Let's go rook d5. So that'll keep his king away from our pawns and our other rook. And now he's only got e7. All right. So we're still a pawn up. We've got his king right in the middle of our camp. Maybe we can checkmate him or something. I don't know. So put your thinking cap on, guys. Type in on the question. What do you reckon black should play here? Should he go for the material like rook d2 again? Should he try and get a checkmate? Should he move a pawn so he doesn't lose on the back rank? What should he do? Derek wants rook c7. Brutus wants rook c7. Thomas and Daniel want rook c7. Everyone's wanting rook c7. Gosh. Absolutely everyone says rook c7 check. What do you reckon, Thomas? Rook c7 check?
Yep, rook c7.
What appeals to you about rook c7 check?
It just gets him back on the back rank, so it'll be easier to make.
Ah, Nathaniel. Well done, Nathaniel, my man. Now, the lesson I'm trying to teach you guys today is don't just check because it's check. You've got to sort of work it out that, yes, I can first this king up and then I'm getting checkmate or something like that. Because black can play one move and white will have to resign. And Nathaniel has found the right move. And the winning move is, in fact, rook c d8. So that cuts off the king. And then next move, we're going to go rook d7 mate. And the only way you can stop it is to put a rook on the d file and give us a free rook. End of game. But all you guys, you did what poor old Sean did. You went rook c7 check because it looks so exciting and it forces the king all the way up to e8. What do you reckon, Thomas? You missed it.
Yeah.
Yeah, all right. Never mind. We've still got his king on d8. Maybe we can still, on e8, maybe we can still finish him off. What do you want to do now?
Now he's there, he's stuck.
You've got no moves. All you've got to do is check him and you win. If you can get a check that he can't get out of. Joshua wants to go rook back to c8, which would set up the same position we had before, but that would be cheating, because I've told you the answer now. I'll show you what Sean did. Sean said, all right, I'm going to double rooks on my second rank, so that king is totally locked in. So So how do you reckon White's plan of attacking King's going so far?
He's attacking, but he's not going very well.
He's attacking, but it could be suicide. He's gone all the way up the other end of the board to E8. And now he thinks, oh, what can I do? There's not much. So White just played A3. Okay. Now, what's poor old Sean as Black going to do? He's got to get some way to sort of back rank that king. What could he do, do you reckon?
It's that rook on the e-file, that's annoying.
Yeah. So how can we reposition our rooks so maybe we can get a checkmate? Maha's got an idea. All right, let's try Maha's idea. She says rook b7.
Yeah.
Which is what was played. Okay. Now White doesn't know what to do, so he goes F4. So we're just fiddling around. So maybe we can get what do you want to do, Thomas?
Either rook to c7. Oh no, D rook to c7.
The D rook. That's B rook would just be repeating position. Let's go to C rook. So now we're threatening c8 checkmate. That'll teach him to be attacking. Right, can White get out of it?
Yeah.
How?
Either rook to d1.
Right, let's put the d rook to d1. All right, what should Black do now? Tell it, let's let everyone help us. We've nearly got him on the back rank checkmate. Black to play, what should Black do here? What do you think? Everyone's thinking hard and not typing it because it's a difficult position. All right. Gil wants to go rook c8 check. Derek wants rook b8 check. Joey wants c8 check. Anyone else want to have a go? We've got two different checks so far, c8 and b8. Josh wants h6. What do you reckon, Thomas?
What would you do?
Got to do something?
C8.
Okay. Well, what Black should just do is say, White's not threatening anything. Why don't I just play, say, G6? So my king can get out, and I'm still a pawn up, so I'll work out how to win later. But, as I said, Black loves checking. So what he played was rook B8 check, which is what some of you suggested.
Yeah.
Now White plays rook d8. Right, what should Black do now? What do you think?
Rook takes rook.
Yep, that's exactly what happened. Now what should happen, Black should say, okay, I'll just put my rook back.
Yeah, put back the b7.
Yep, and White hasn't got any threats, and it's all fine. But White, Black said, oh, goody, look, heaven on earth, I've got both a capture and a check. So he plays rook takes rook check, which was what you suggested. King takes, and then his rook's attacked. So he moved his rook to b7, and White said, thank you for the game. Rook e8, back rank checkmate. So how terrible is that?
Wow.
Wow, so the attacking king won. Oh, but only because poor old Black, he loved checking and he loved taking. When he should have just said, I'm going to polish off your army, I'm going to play rook d2, take all your pawns and whatever. Okay, so that was a very surprising game. We thought White was going to get checkmated and he should have been checkmated, but he ended up swindling. But I hope that's a good lesson to you guys. What do you think? So the king is
not expecting that.
And we shouldn't just swap pieces because we can, and we shouldn't just check because we can. So if you guys learned that lesson, I'm sure that'll serve you well in your games coming forth. All right, I'm a little bit over time today, so apologies for taking a bit longer than usual, but I hope you enjoyed the finish of that. And I look forward to seeing you all next week. Thanks and good night.
Yeah.
The organizer has ended the session.